Welcome everybody, I'm Jason, the creator of the Tabletop Battlefield. That's taken you back a long time, almost 10 years ago when I created that miniature wargaming show. It was like the original podcast for Tabletop Wargaming. No, I'm sorry, not the original podcast for Wargaming, I got it wrong. The original video podcast for Tabletop Wargaming. I'm pretty certain we were the first on the internet to do this kind of stuff. And every now and then, I still put this old shirt back on and try some things out again. And today, I am here painting up the brand new Kairos Fate Weaver miniature kit from Games Workshop. This thing just came out yesterday. I managed to get a copy of it in the inevitable bloodbath of trying to fight for these miniatures. Fortunately, I just pre-ordered it and I wandered in at 4 o'clock and picked up a copy. But apparently, other than pre-orders, I think they got like two of these in stock yesterday at the local Games Workshop store, and they were supposedly gone within about 30 seconds. So if you didn't pre-order it, well, you can watch me paint this guy up today. This is one of the two variations of the Lord of Change miniature kit. This is Kairos Fate Weaver, who is one of the greater demons of Tzeentch. And I'm going to start working on him here in just a moment. So as we go along here, I'm going to be talking a little bit about what I'm doing painting-wise. And I'm going to go ahead and also talk about some other random things. I do run a tabletop game company that produces a space combat miniatures game called Legends of Caladagia. So feel free to not only ask questions about what I'm doing painting-wise, but also if you want to ask any questions about the tabletop game industry, you're welcome to do that. And in case we feel like it, I've brought up here on my tablet my old hack HP touchpad running some old version of Android. It's a nice steering system. I actually brought up the most recent half-yearly report of Games Workshop's financials. So if you're interested in hearing about some of the details of a tabletop game company like Games Workshop, because they're the only publicly traded tabletop game company in the world, it'd be fun to talk about some of those details. So let me go ahead and get started. Let me slide over to my work camera and we can go from there. So this monster here is the brand new Kairos Fate Weaver miniature. It is one of the two variations you can build from the Lord of Change miniature kit. One of them, obviously the other one being the Tzeentch Greater Demon Lord of Change. And this is, I think, the unique character version. And I've always wanted this particular miniature. I think the idea of having this two-headed demon bird thing is pretty freaking awesome. I just never got around to buying the original miniature. So when this one popped up available for pre-order, I'm like, okay, definitely have to give this a try. Because this miniature is absolutely fantastic. It's an all-plastic kit. And it's just a beast. It's just awesome. So let me start talking about here painting it. Now, normally Kairos is blue. I'm actually going to be starting working with some Caliban green, and there's actually a funny story behind why I'm using Caliban green. Caliban green is something I use in a lot of my other miniatures. I historically use green for some reason in a lot of my guys. Here is one of my Gar Empire battle suits from Beyond the Gates of Antares. A lot of green there. And if I were to go and run around and grab some of my Tau Empire guys, which I don't actually have around at the moment, they're also painted in a lot of green because, frankly, it's just cheap to kind of use the same miniature, same paints over and over and over again. But anyway, so why in particular for Kairos here, where I'm doing green instead of his normal blue, is I actually ran out of this particular Caliban green color, and then I bought a new bottle. And it turns out I forgot that I bought a new bottle and put it in a drawer and I forgot about it. About, you know, a few weeks later, I realized, oh, I still have the empty bottle laying around that I didn't get rid of. So I thought, oh, wait a minute, I'm out of Caliban green again. Not remembering that I actually bought a previous bottle already. And then I went to the store and bought a second brand new bottle. So now I have two nearly full pods of Caliban green. There's the other one. Two nearly full pods of Caliban green that I needed to use up. So why not use them on a giant miniature like Kairos Fate Weaver? And it doesn't help the fact that I opened both of them. So it's not like that one's not opened. I opened both of them because I forgot that I had one. So I got two almost full pods of paint to go ahead and try to use here. So this would be a great project to use them on. Throughout the project, I've been working with a couple different brushes. I've got So this is the Winsor & Newton Series 7 brush. This is one of the really super expensive high-end brushes you can get. Absolutely fantastic brush. It does it really great at holding its tip there with its bristles. And then I've also got an artificial layer brush. This is Games Workshop Citadel branded high-end brush. Some people have claimed that it's just a rebranded Series 7 Winsor & Newton I just showed you there, and it's quite possible it is. The quality level is nearly identical. It's absolutely fantastic. And finally, for dry brushing, I've got one of the Citadel dry brushes, which seems to be working pretty good because it's got nice stiff bristles, because dry brushing normally just brutally annihilates your brushes. And I've got a few other crappier brushes here for things like glue and stuff like that, but I haven't got them on the base yet. I figured it'd be easier to paint just without the base, because the way the miniature is assembled, you don't really need to do a lot of sub-assemblies with them. You can pretty much access every side of the miniature, you know, without too much difficulty, you know, when he's fully assembled. You know, some miniatures, they kind of pieces that overlap each other. He really doesn't. So I was able to assemble him, and I think you can paint him up pretty easily without having to rely on smaller pieces and sub-assemblies. Okay, so let me go ahead and actually get started with the painting. I'm going to be using the Winsor & Newton. It's a little bit Winsor & Newton Series 7 brush. It is a little bit larger than the artificial brush. The artificial brush is the smallest size brush that Games Workshop sells. But hey, it's still, it seems like it's kind of a large brush, but it still, you know, works pretty good. This would be a nice job for an airbrush, but I actually don't have one, so that's why I'm going to stick with the brushes. And I'm just going to paint his feathers, giving him a nice dark green base. It's a base paint. It's a little bit of water to thin it down. And just start slapping this paint on this guy. The first step is honestly not that big of a deal. I can kind of do more or less whatever I want here. I'm going to try to avoid what are the obvious decorations and pendants and things that he's wearing. The tongue is probably not going to be green. That'd be kind of, oh, I don't know. It's a demon. You can do whatever you want, right? But there's a lot of surface area to cover with the green paint. And you know, you don't even have to get all of it. Having a little bit of variation is not a big deal. Plus, Caliban green is a very dark green color. It goes on kind of bright, but it dries fairly dark. So it almost just gives a miniature, oh, there's that one of those armor things I said I was not going to try to paint. So it almost gives the miniature just a little bit of a greenish hue. It's the other highlights that really will bring out the green color in the feathers that I'm going to be using. Let's see, he's got, what's going on with his chest here? I'm trying to figure out if his chest is feathers or not. Let me look at the box art. So I may end up painting his chest different color. Obviously his neck and is a feathers, and of course, you know, wings, well, they're feathers because he's a giant bird demon. I don't know about his chest. I got his the box art down here in just a moment. I'll pull that out and see if that is feathers also. Because if it's not, I might try a different color. I mean, probably a pale yellowish color or something would work pretty good as a complementary color to green. It often does. And also would help to get an idea of exactly what's armor and what's not. Some of the areas like on his legs, I can't tell if they're skin or armor from the miniature. I is a little bit unwieldy trying to paint some this big, so maybe even though you don't necessarily have to approach sub-assemblies, you can reach everything on the model, he's just kind of big, so maybe I should have done that approach from the beginning. Just something to think about if you're painting up one of these guys. How would you break it down? I mean, the wings are separate pieces, so you could have each wing be a separate piece. So the wings themselves are not attached together, they're attached to his back. So you probably could have the torso and the arms and legs, it's all one piece. You build those in the first couple steps. And the wings you build separately and eventually stick into slots in the back of the torso.
So you could easily have a situation like that, where you have each of the wings, you could paint those up and then stick them in. Because they're so big, they're actually kind of heavy, even for, you know, being a plastic miniature. That's having trouble having the plastic glue actually stick and hold the wings in place. I ended up super gluing them in with some type of a Gorilla Glue super glue, which actually works pretty good. I'd never tried it before. And also then having to use some of the accelerant. Because the wings were so heavy, the plastic glue wouldn't cure right away, and they kind of started to fall out after about 30 seconds. So it might not be a bad idea to actually paint the wings separately, because as I'm moving this guy around here, the wings are kind of scraping against the ground, and you kind of risk damaging them a little bit. But, you know, Kairos is kind of an old demon. If he has a little bit of damaged wings, that just kind of adds his character, right? So yesterday, also, I got to play the new Blood Bowl game from Games Workshop, which, conveniently, is just the old Blood Bowl game. I remember back in the Tabletop Battlefield, I think Season 3, we did a review of the Blood Bowl game. I'm pretty sure I was fairly positive on it. And I did enjoy it last night. I mean, It's probably a game that I think you play it a few more times, you'd enjoy it a little bit more, because the first time you play it, getting all the rules and tactics down is a little slow. But I imagine once you know what you're doing, you can really pick up the game and go pretty fast with it. But it is essentially almost 90-some percent the game that we reviewed all those years ago. My goodness, how long ago was that? Season 3 would have been like 8 years ago in the Tabletop Battlefield. It's insane. Yeah, the Tabletop Battlefield now has technically been around for almost a decade. It's holy crap. It's one of those things where it's like you sit down and think about how long you've been doing something, and it's like 10 years for the Tabletop Battlefield. Because the first show was January 17th-ish, 2007. Let me switch to the other camera. It'd be easier to show it up. So there's the actual Lord of Change box. And yeah, his body is not feathers. And going down the inside of the legs, not feathers. It looks like I'm not sure if his legs are feathers, but the actual artwork is painted the same way as the rest of the feathers, so maybe I'll do that. But he does have some sort of pale skin-like thing going on here in the middle. And actually, that's a Lord of Change. They have Kairos in the back, who has same kind of thing, pale skin in the middle, but his is like a more of a lighter bluish color. So maybe I'll go with like a lighter greenish color. Ooh, that red and pink is pretty. I don't know if I can do something like that, but that is a very pretty color. I'll probably do like orange, because you know I like orange for some reason. Even though orange is historically a horrific color to paint, this troll slayer orange stuff is just a nightmare, but you know. So I might not actually paint the most of the wing feathers. I'll probably not paint those green then. Let's just work on the arms. But anyway, the Blood Bowl. So I played the Skaven team, just got tromped. Let's see, what's the final score? The final score, I think, was 3-1, I lost. Though it should have been 2-1. My opponent, who's Jerry, who's been on the Tabletop Battlefield a few times, he was the official Warhammer 40K historian. He was playing one of the old school teams, like the Norse. And though they weren't, the technically aren't really tougher than the Skaven, he just got really, really lucky in armor break and injury rolls where I didn't. Plus, he's a little bit better at figuring out the tactics behind the pushing and the blocking and things. He definitely had better opportunities with his block rolls to do injuries. So in that regard, he's definitely a better performance than me, but he did get a lot more lucky when it came to making armor rolls and injuries. And by the basically halfway through the second half, I was down to under half my team in the field because I was using the brand new Skaven miniatures that they DW released. It's $35, I think, for a box of 12. If fantastic miniatures, because, you know, Games Workshop makes fantastic miniatures. There's no doubt about that. But 12 guys is not enough for a Skaven team, because they just get stomped on and squished, and it just gets ugly. So, if you do play Skaven, pick up more than just the, like, 12 miniatures that come in the box. Probably pick up 2 boxes, which then you have way too many miniatures, but welcome to Games Workshop. So I'm going to paint like the initial kind of insides of the wings here. I'm going to paint them the Caliban green, but I'm going to try to figure out how to make it fade into something else. I like that pink they did, but I don't have any pink, so it won't be that. I don't know what other crazy idea I'll try. It's like, I don't know, you know, I'll just try different colors. I do like the whole green, brown, orange combination. For some reason, that orange is a nice clashing color, and I actually really like it when I paint these guys like this. Some people like it, some people don't, and I've gotten feedback both ways with my Tau Fire Warriors who are painting the same green, brown, bright orange scheme. But the short answer is Blood Bowl, same game. If you liked it before, it's not a bad idea to pick up a copy. One of the only real change, the big noticeable change about the components, other than the fact, you know, they're higher quality miniatures now than the ones that came in the original starter set, but the starter set's still orcs versus basic humans. The board is much bigger, which is a good thing. Before, the miniatures barely fit in the squares, and if you had, like, the big guy, the Croxigor or something, he didn't fit in the square. Now, you can easily fit a 40mm giant base in the squares, and they had different pitches, too, so we're playing on the Skaven home turf last night, which didn't help, because I still got tromped. But they're very pretty boards, they have pretty artworks. I think right now, officially, that it's out in terms of miniatures. You have humans, orcs, skavens, and dwarves. I don't think they call them the Dwarden. I think they're still actually called dwarves, not Dwarden. Trademark fail. If you don't play Age of Sigmar at all, all the races in the fantasy realm got new trademarkable names, because dwarves and elves and lizardmen aren't trademarkable, but Dwarden, elves or something, I don't even know how you pronounce the new elven name. It's like Aelf or something like that, and then the lizardmen are now the Seraphon. Because they're space dragons. Alright, he's coming along pretty good here. Gotta keep him in camera. But other than, see, Blood Bowl, what other new games have I played recently? This past year, you know, I just mentioned on the Christmas episode of the Tabletop Battlefield, it's been mostly Warlord. I haven't played much in the way of Games Workshop recently. The reason, I guess, the issue I've had with Warhammer 40K, Age of Sigmar is a different story, we can talk about that in a minute. When it comes to Warhammer 40K, the style that the game is morphed into, I'm not a real big fan of. It still can be a lot of fun. But like when I was at the store, the GW store yesterday, you know, I was watching some guys play Tau Empire versus Space Wolves. Yes, Space Wolves, let me get that right. I always tend to call the Space Wolves the Steel Wolves, which were a faction from MechWarrior Dark Age. But that's what happens when you play 17 games or more over the course of 20 years. Everything molded together. But yeah, it was Tau Empire versus Space Wolves. In the way the Tau Empire player built his list, he had the Hunter Cadre, which is one of the new formations, and I think he had like the 3 sub-formations. I don't even know. I don't even have the most recent Tau Codex. I just kind of gave up on it. He would pick out a target in the enemy unit, and basically the entire army got Ballistic Skill 6 against it. So what's happening with 40K is that it's really becoming about building a list that just it comes power on top of power on top of power, and just amplifies the overall effect of your army. And that's, I don't really enjoy that type of meta. War Machine has that, and you know, it's like, the problem I run into with that is it's not that the games aren't fun to play. 40K, like I said, it can be a heck of a lot of fun to play in the right scenarios. And same with War Machine. I love the rules of War Machine. I love the story of it. I love the, you know, the miniatures are fantastic. And it's fun when you just toss some random miniatures out there and try to have a crazy game. But when the game becomes so much about list building to where the games morph into a giant aspect of paper, rock, scissors for like 2 hours, it's not particular fun to do that. And the few times I played 7th edition, it kind of became that. And the one, you know, and it's just like, I don't really want to play a game where it's about, you know, maxing out the potential power of your army to the upper limit, and basically you know who's going to win or lose by the time you get in the tabletop. It's just kind of, it doesn't, it takes away, it can, I mean, I won't say it always will, but it can take away from a lot of the actual on-battlefield tactics and moving guys around and choosing who to shoot at and trying to capture objectives if your army just has the firepower to wipe out the enemy in the course of a game without too much difficulty. And that's particularly why I haven't played Warhammer 40,000 much in the past few years. 8th edition, which is, you know, the rumors have been around for a while, I'll certainly be willing to give that a try. I'm, you know, I still love the Warhammer 40K universe. I picked up Fall of Cadia a few weeks ago when that came out. I tried to order the second Gathering Storm book yesterday, and apparently by 4 o'clock in the afternoon, they're all sold out. I'm really hoping those books are not some, like, limited edition bullcrap that GW likes to pull every now and then. I'm not a big fan of when core stuff to the story or core miniatures are limited edition. I don't mind having, like, a limited edition version of the books like they do with the Codex. You know, where you can buy, like, there's 1,000 copies of a limited edition of Codex. That's fine. That's cool. But, you know, the general core Codex, the minimum you need to play with, that's always going to be available. I like that particular style of things, you know, where you can always be guaranteed to still get what you need to play the game. I don't mind having limited edition miniatures that are alternate variations or something special about them, but... So alternative pose miniatures, things like that, where you still have everything available for people to play the game, but, you know, you just have some special miniatures that look different, or, you know, or maybe they're a special character that isn't that big of a deal. That doesn't really bother me too much. But if the fact is I can't get this core book because they only want to produce so many of them, that's really annoying. Then you really got to start fighting for it, and then people start buying them and resell them on eBay. Talks to the guy who resells Warhammer stuff on eBay. I resell used Warhammer stuff. I'm not one of those people who will go and pre-order something that I think is going to be big and then try to get, like, you know, like a 50% markup on eBay. I don't like doing that. I think that's kind of cheesy and lame. But if it's an old item that's no longer available, that's fair game, because, you know, you've had 5 years to try to pick up a copy of it. And if that's my attitude. It's sort of arbitrary, but, you know, I'm fine with that. I gotta be careful. His staff, which is called the Staff of Tomorrow, is kind of flimsy when you gotta put the giant weight of the miniature on it. But man, it looks awesome. How did I get off on that tangent? I do this when I'm recording these shows. I'm just kind of go off on these totally bizarrely random tangents. I'm like, oh well, let's talk about this for a while, and this. I'm like, okay. So I was talking about why I don't play Warhammer 40K anymore, or War Machine for that matter. I did pick up 3rd edition War Machine. I read through the rules. It's War Machine. A little bit, they cleaned up some stuff up, and the rule book, I must say, is fantastic. It might be the best written rule book I've ever seen in terms of actually being useful as a rule book. Compared to Games Workshop's and so on. I'll never let them down for that and so on comment. I don't remember where that was. That was an Overwatch phase, I think, where they talked about, it's sort of like a shooting phase, where this, and so on. where they list like two special abilities related to shooting but not the other 15, and then people spend the next 7 years trying to figure out what do they mean. And they're doing a better, Games Workshop's doing a much better job supporting their stuff right now. The Warhammer Live stuff's really great. That's fun to watch. I've subscribed to that, so I enjoy watching it, but playing the game, you know, not the biggest fan right now. Now with Age of Sigmar, I haven't played since the General's Handbook came out, so that could make things kind of, that obviously makes things different. You get more of a structured match play effect. You've got some missions that look pretty cool. I've watched, you know, like in Warhammer Live, they show off some of the missions that are from that book, and they look pretty cool. I mean, they look like they'd be fun to play, so I might be willing to give that a shot. But I think the issue they ran into there with Age of Sigmar, with Warhammer Fantasy players, which aside from the fact that, you know, you change a game up significantly, people are going to be angry no matter what, whether it's better or worse, it doesn't matter, it's different, people are going to be angry, that's just the way things work. I think it was, yeah, Age of Sigmar we talked about 2 years ago in the Tabletop Battlefield Christmas special. Age of Do Whatever You Feel Like or something like that. Yeah, pretty much. But before the General's Handbook, where it was just kind of throw down whatever you felt like and see what happens, it just came very easy to have games that were just way out of balance. I don't know if the games are really well balanced now. Like I said, I haven't played it much. But when I was like, bring 30 models. I brought my Bastiladon with like a laser beam on his back, which is freaking hilarious. But hilarious because you got a giant dinosaur with a laser beam on his back. Not hilarious because it's necessarily fun. It just cut through like entire infantry squads and stuff. So, I don't know. It could be... I might try it again, but... Oh, what is... Man, I got random tangent again. I might try it again. But I think the issue they had with Age of Sigmar, which, I don't know, who knows what Games Workshop was thinking. You don't know what they're thinking when it comes to designing stuff, how much they really think about things, or... They obviously got to make a decision whether they care or not. But tactics-wise, if you tried to play Age of Sigmar like Warhammer Fantasy, you didn't get a very good experience. Which isn't necessarily a bad thing, especially if they were kind of like given a bit of a middle finger to the Warhammer Fantasy crew. I don't know if they were intended to or not. Because obviously they had to do something. If Warhammer Fantasy wasn't selling, it doesn't matter how big your player base is. If you're not paying money to the company, you really can't expect them to be loyal to you. It's a weird thing you have to think about. Like, you know, with Legends of Caladagia, it does come down to how much are you selling. You know, if the initial game, you know, the first edition of Legends of Caladagia, after a couple of years, wasn't selling nearly as good as it was when it first came out. And I'll be honest, that's the main reason why I released second edition. I changed things up quite a bit. It's not that I necessarily wanted to have to radically change things up, though I kind of did, to be honest with you. I wanted to try to do something a little bit different. But yeah, but there's definitely a sales motivation going on there, because over time, your sales probably are going to drop a little bit, especially in the case of Games Workshop, where they've got a market saturation issue, but we don't need to worry about that in this. I'll talk more about that later. I probably have talked about that in this live stream before. And you could dive in back into what I was showing the financial reports there. In regards to, you know, going from Warhammer Fantasy to Age of Sigmar, revenues had been dropping at Games Workshop. They were, over the past few years, up until this most recent report that I showed you, where it was a huge jump in revenue, that may have partially had to do with some currency-ish things going on. That, I must admit, I don't quite get. But like the actual revenue that was gained was a lot more than percentage-wise and constant currency revenue. That's Kyle's department. If I can ever get a hold of that guy again. I shouldn't be joking about that stuff on the live stream. I'm sure I'll talk to him soon. I gotta talk to him soon. I mean, I got his copy of Deadpool here. He's gonna want that back at some point. We both have just been really, really busy with things. So I don't. That's the main thing going on. What is I talking? I'm just jumping all over the board. But you know, that's what I do when I'm I'm kind of thinking out loud right now, because that's what happens in these live streams. I'm just thinking out loud. I'm like, oh, well, what about this? What about that? I don't even know. Okay. I was talking about constant currency revenue. Oh, yes. So, my brain right now is backtracking through the conversation that I just had with myself, trying to figure out what it was that I was trying to say and where I'm going from here. So give me a moment. Let's see. I was talking about how, tactics-wise, Age of Sigmar didn't play like Warhammer Fantasy, and if you did, it wasn't very fun, which, you know, they probably thought about, but said, oh, well, whatever. People weren't buying stuff, so they don't expect to be loyal to the company. Yeah, okay. Yeah, because the revenues at Games Workshop have been dropping over the past few years, up until the most recent one, where they shot up, like, pretty, actually, quite by quite a bit. But they would drop in, I almost want to say, over the last 4 or 5 years, somewhere between a 5 and 10% drop in the revenue stream of Games Workshop. It was a fairly substantial drop from a company. Granted, any revenue loss in a company is bad, but when you start seeing close to double digits revenue, that's going to get your investors a little bit ticked off. Because, you know, Games Workshop is a publicly traded company. They have all the pressures of making, you know, keeping revenue up. Whereas maybe a privately traded company, like Privateer Press or somebody, not privately traded, it's not a real thing, a privately owned company. I don't know if there is such a thing as a privately traded company. That's a Cal question again. But a non-public company anyway, they may not have to freak out quite as much because the revenues drop a little bit. So Games Workshop was in a situation where, you know, the revenues were in decline. They had to do something. I think they tried that whole approach where you saw, release more stuff. Release tons of stuff. Lots of stuff. As much stuff as you possibly could. You had armies coming out once a month. They effectively doubled their miniature production rate. And they've kind of cut back on that, I think. I mean, so far this year, all we've seen is the Triumphant and then Tzeentch. So we had Tzeentch in January. Just January, as I like to call it. The Triumphant for Warhammer 40K. I don't know. I'll have to keep an eye on it, see if they slowed things down a little bit or not. Because the point though is that faster pace of releases didn't actually really help them. Revenue was still going down, which that's kind of a problem when you think about it, right? Because you're releasing twice as much stuff. You want your customers to spend more money, but they're not. So you've now increased production costs, research and development costs, and you're not seeing a gain in revenue. And especially, you know, with Warhammer Fantasy, if that really wasn't selling, they had to do something different, and eventually they said, well, let's try Age of Sigmar. And I don't know, it's... See, the one thing we don't get with the GW financial reports is we don't get how the individual games are doing. We get revenue broken down by miniature sales, by royalties, and then the miniature sales then are broken down a little bit further by trade, which is the independent retail channel, and that's usually, I think, around 40%-ish. It might be 40 or 45%-ish of GW's revenue comes from independent retailers. They have retail, which is Games Workshop's own stores all across the world, and that's also a similar amount, somewhere in the neighborhood of 40 to 45%. And then finally, they have the third category is online, and this includes their web store, and this includes also Forge World. Now, I don't know where Black Library fits into all that. Obviously, Black Library being the novel publication aspect of Games Workshop. And those are sold not only through their web store and their actual retail stores and other trade stores. They also go into big box stores, being primarily like bookstores like Barnes & Noble. Are there any other bookstores left? Maybe smaller bookstores might stock a few of them. I'm not entirely sure. We don't really have a whole lot of independent bookstores around here in Michigan, at least this area of Michigan. There's one in Ann Arbor, but they do a lot of more used books. You can find some used Warhammer stuff there. That's probably be factored into the trade section. That'd be my guess, because that's, you know, third party retailers. But I'm not sure if I've really broken it down that detailed before with their revenue. I'd have to look into that. So the point of that long-winded thing is, if stuff isn't selling, they need to do something different. And when it came to Age of Sigmar, we knew we could kind of compare the previous year, because GW's financial years run from mid-year to mid-year. I want to say it's June 1st to June 1st, because the first half of the year just ended for them, but it ends in the end of October. It does not include the Christmas season. Or sorry, end of November. It doesn't include the Christmas season. Or not much of the Christmas shopping season, right? Because you can kind of say, well, Christmas starts, you know, on Thanksgiving. But so you get a little bit of the Christmas season in the first half of the financial year for Games Workshop. But what we were able to, because of the fact that it's about middle of the year, you were able to compare revenue-wise Age of Sigmar's first year versus the last year, the end times of Warhammer Fantasy Battles. And what you actually saw was the revenues were about the same. I think the Age of Sigmar year, revenues were down a tiny bit, but like maybe 1%. Which initially would lead you to speculation that one of two things was possible. Because like I said, we don't get any information about how well any individual game is doing, because who knows how well The Hobbit's doing. I don't know if they even sell that in the local GW stores. There might be a small section for The Hobbit. I honestly don't know. I've never looked. One side is all 40K. One side is 40K and Age of Sigmar. And the other side is a lot of like kind of starter sets. They have some of the, they have what's new, and they have some of the boxes, you know, Dark Vengeance, and then the several different Age of Sigmar starter sets. Here's how to start painting, here's how to start playing, blah, blah, blah. I actually don't know if there's any Hobbit stuff in there. There might be a small section. Because then the third part, the other part of the wall is a lot of the hobby materials, bases, things like that. So like I said, we don't really get details of what's going on via the game line, but you can kind of start speculating a little bit, right? If revenues are relatively constant from year to year, that means your new game, either A, did not sell as well as the old game did in the last year, which is a possibility. I mean, End Times was really popular. A lot of players bought into that stuff. And you could argue maybe that's what Games Workshop should have been doing all along, is having big sweeping story arcs, you know, like The Gathering Storm. And Realmgate Wars, I think, was one. So maybe they're going to try that model. But that's possibility one. Or possibility two, if Age of Sigmar was doing fairly well, then that would mean that Warhammer 40K was dropping down faster than expected. Or was dropping down fast, but Age of Sigmar is only just barely picking up the slack. And like I said, we don't really know which one of those was the case. What we do know, in that report I showed, I held up at the start there for this year, there was about for the first half of the year, for financial year 2015, they made something like 55 million pounds. That was the first half of the year. For the first half of the year for 2016 financial year, which would be this year, going in, you know, second half of 2016, first half of 2017, they made something like 77 million pounds. Now the pound, the British pound, probably thanks partially, if not fully, to that Brexit mess that if maybe you may not have been following along with the United Kingdom voting to leave the European Union at some point in the near future. I almost got enough green on here. I'm just kind of blobbing on green as I talk. So there was definitely some devaluation in the British pound currency. So it worked out to be something like 15% revenue increase factoring in constant currency, which implies, you know, had the British pound stayed the same, because I'm pretty sure their constant currency measurement is going to be the British pound. If that would have stayed the same, then they would have seen a 15% revenue increase instead of the, you know, much larger, almost 30% revenue increase that they actually got if you compare just raw numbers, which is still absolutely fantastic for a company to see a 15% constant currency revenue increase. So Games Workshop just killed it this last 6 months I don't know exactly what they did to do that. Maybe Age of Sigmar has finally picked up. It took it a year, and it's really kicked in. But they absolutely killed it. It's right now, it's about 4:30, so I'll probably stick around for another 15 minutes doing this. I've got the basic, I think I've got the basic dark green areas are going to be green pretty well done. I'm going to start applying some highlights to them a little bit. This will be an adventure. I'm trying to decide, how do I want to do this? So I could do some dry brushing. Or I could try to be a very detailed kind of work. What I'm going to be using here is Warpstone Glow. And I'm going to be pulling out then the extra small artificial layer brush. So, let me just start doing that. And I'm going to start blabbering some more about the Gathering Storm. Why? Because, like I said, we go back to Warhammer 40,000 with 8th edition. Lots of rumors forever and ever and ever. I have, you know, Jerry, who you know, I mentioned ago, I was playing Blood Bowl with last night, has always wanted to sit down and track rumors. And not in the sense to see if anybody actually seems to have a reliable source. Because you always hear all sorts of crazy crap. Every week, hey, there's some new, here's the news details of the new starter set for Warhammer 40K. They're going to make the Age of Sigmar. They're going to do this, blah, 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 and so on. And most of them probably end up being absolute crap. But I think it'd be interesting to see, you know, sit down and measure those things and just see how many times people actually get rumors correctly. Or get rumors correct. And see if anybody in particular, some of these supposed sources, are actually pretty good. Because who knows? I mean, because Games Workshop or any company, they're working months to years ahead of time. I really have no idea, for example, like this Lord of Change miniature in here, how long this thing has been in development. I mean, it's partially going to be driven by financials. If a particular miniature line is not selling too well anymore, they'll probably start putting resources in to improve it. Of course, then you got the whole Sisters debacle, where people are like, we want Plastic Sisters. And they joke about it in the trash bin. Well, you didn't technically get Plastic Sisters. You got St. Celestine. So there technically is a Plastic Sisters out. But anyway, with the Gathering Storm, it's a series for Warhammer 40,000. It's not, you know, it's an actual, they're game supplements. They're not novels. There may be novels that go with them, but they actually are game supplements. I've got the first one, Fall of Cadia, in which Cadia blows up, which is kind of a big thing. But what it kind of reminds me of, especially since they're blowing Cadia up in this one, and I'm not entirely sure what the details of the second one are. Something about an Eldar, God of the Dead, coming back, but I really don't know Eldar very well. So I'm kind of doing a little bit, I'm playing around with some weird technique here. I'm applying some of the paint using the layer brush, and then I'm kind of taking the dry brush and kind of spreading out a little bit. Because I feel I'm putting a little too much of the layer paint on. I'm applying a little bit too thick, I think. But the Gathering Storm, like, it does feel very similar to Warhammer's Fantasy's End Times, where they're obviously building to something big. We've now seen some rumors about the third one, Rise of the Primarchs, Reboot Guilliman or something. I don't know, I can't pronounce his name, apparently it's French. He's coming back, he's meeting up with Cypher from the Dark Angels, and they're trying to head to Terra. So something is building here, and it's entirely possible that the end of all this is 8th edition Warhammer 40K. That would be my guess, is that they're going to build up, because they're doing the same kind of business model they did with the End Times. You've got a new rule book that has a lot of stuff in it, and then you've got a series of miniatures featuring the major characters in it. So it's quite entirely possible what we're going to see here at the end is this is leading up to 8th edition. I don't have any inside sources on that. I don't work for Games Workshop, nor do I have any desire to work for them. I run my own tabletop game company, thank you very much, and I personally enjoy that a lot more than trying to run one of their stores. That would just be a nightmare. Someday maybe I'll run a game store. I've looked in the details of I've had people, friends, try to run, look in the details of it. It's not a pretty financial situation, I'll put it that way. Games Workshop is kind of has an advantage of the fact they don't have to make a whole lot of profit on them, if any at all. But anyway, I digress again. That'd be another fun topic to talk about. But the Gathering Storm series does seem like it's leading up to something, i.e. 8th edition. Now, would Games Workshop Sigmarith Warhammer 40K? I really don't think that they would. I think that'd be kind of crazy on their part to do that. And the reasoning for that is that financially, they don't need to do that. Now, they could be in a bit of a funny spot financially. Because, you know, you don't, if you don't need to totally rehash a game to save revenue or increase revenue, you're not going to do that because you're going to lose players. You know, you're going to tick people off. You're going to lose players. There's going to be a bit of a loss to it. So they have to do some sort of business calculation in their head to say, if we were to Sigmarify, is that a word, Sigmarify Warhammer 40K, they have to, you know, acknowledge the fact, okay, it's going to cost us this much in expected player base, and it's probably going to take 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, whatever, to return the revenue to normal. Now, as I mentioned a little bit ago, Games Workshop, up until recently, their revenues have been sliding. So maybe they've been thinking about this, okay, a few years out, you know, revenues are dropping a little bit, not critical, but they are dropping. Maybe we need to sit down and think about what we're going to do differently. Because you have to do something. You know, if revenues are dropping, you have to do something. So maybe, you know, 3 years, 2 years ago when revenues were still dropping, they're thinking, okay, well, let's start figuring out 8th edition. You know, 7th edition 40K had been out for a year, and that hadn't really turned things around very much. It stopped bleeding a little bit, you know, numbers-wise, but maybe they still wanted to get revenues back up to where they were in years past. So let's start thinking about 8th edition. How can we increase our player base? And they may be thinking, well, let's it's a made-up word. That's why I keep stumbling over it. Sigmarify. It's an absolute made-up word. Let's say they want to do that to Warhammer 40,000. It would be an awful big risk because Warhammer 40,000 is still bringing in tons of revenue. Not, you know, it's probably still by far, it's probably still bigger than Age of Sigmar. I'm almost certain it'd have to be. So I don't, just by pure financials, my point is they probably wouldn't be making that much of a drastic change because it is still bringing in a lot of money. But they may have been planning some sort of big change. Only to this, kind of funny, big chains and paying Zinch manager. they're going all Zinch on you. But the fact is that since revenues of the first half of last year were so incredible relative to the previous years, to the point where they've almost, if, and then of course this is obviously an if the second half of the year revenues are just as well as the first half of the year, they've almost wiped out a lot of the damage that had happened over the past few years. They could be in a bit of a bind where they're making radical changes to Warhammer 40K to get people, like, for example, me, because they do specifically mention we want to bring in customers who have relapsed, you know, who've lapsed a little bit, and that would be someone like me who hasn't played the game in 3 years. They want to bring them back into the hobby to get us to keep buying miniatures again. I don't really buy miniatures very much. This Lord of Change guy was an exception because I've always wanted his miniature. They may have planned something kind of big, and they financially now, maybe they don't really need it. So if we do see some radical changes to Warhammer 40,000 this year. That's basically the point I'm trying to make, is that it's probably because they were trying to do something drastic to bring their revenues back up, but now they, right at the moment, they don't need to. So who knows what'll happen. I don't, like I said, I still don't think there will be any huge changes. There's a lot of things that can be cleaned up with 40K. They've got so many different rules going on, trying to interact with each other. They can clean stuff up. The whole monstrous creatures versus vehicles, they may go, that may go kind of Age of Sigmar-ish, where they just have lots of wounds. Because it is kind of funny that, like, you know, a dreadnought is a vehicle that functions like a vehicle. The Tau Riptide is a monstrous creature, even though it's a giant mechanical robot. So there's things like that could definitely streamline and clean up, merge some of the special powers together. So there's definitely some cleanup work they could very easily do, and that's probably what they will do, make things play maybe a little bit faster. Because Warhammer 40K can take a heck of a long time to play, a lot longer than it used to. I love watching the Warhammer Live stuff, where they, like, 2.5 hours into the thing, well, we're kind of out of time here, that was a good 2-turn game. It happens. So, if anything they need to do, it would be focused on speeding the game up a little bit more. I would like, you know, see them get away from the meta building. I don't think they're going to do that. Age of Sigmar is definitely not getting away from that. So I wouldn't expect them to make such a radical change in Warhammer 40K. And that's what they would really need to do to bring me back into the hobby. But you never know. We'll see what they do. But I think the Gathering Storm is leading up to Warhammer 40K 8th Edition. That's right. I bumped into my microphone probably 3 or 4 times today. It's like right above my head. So, well, someone joined me here. So whoever joined me, thanks for taking a look at the show. I'm just painting up the brand new Kairos Fate Weaver miniature. And I spent the last 45 minutes talking about some of my thoughts on the current financial situation with Games Workshop and how the Gathering Storm series for Warhammer 40,000 could very easily be leading up to the Warhammer 8th edition, because it does resemble the end times for Warhammer Fantasy Battle. So if you have any questions as to what I'm doing, feel free to ask away. And if you want to ask any questions about the tabletop game industry, go right ahead. I do run my own tabletop game company. So I definitely have some insight a little bit into the business side of things. Joys of streaming live on twitch.tv. This is probably what I get for streaming live when the LVO is going on and there's some big football game here in about an hour and a half, I think. I actually have no idea. I don't watch football and I'm cool with that. That is looking pretty though. I like that green highlights. I'm liking how that wing's looking. This is going to take forever, but it's looking pretty cool. But that's all right. Plenty of time for me to sit here and just make and talk about random stuff. So what else? Oh yeah, that's the other thing I've played recently from Games Workshop. We played through, friends and I played through a handful of missions from Warhammer Quest Silver Tower. That game is, it's very frustrating. It's a neat little system. It's pretty cool. It's fun, but it gets very repetitive. The missions are built from a deck of cards. And there's, the book says, you know, get these so many cards out, then you put a, there's a finish, a final room for each mission you stick in somewhere near the bottom of the deck, and you know, you use these four rooms, you reveal cards, and go through there. And what ends up happening is it really feels like what you're doing is you're just kind of playing through the same, you know, 10, 15 different rooms with some unique final battle. Some gimmick at the end of the battle that makes it a little bit different. So it's an, like I said, it's a neat system, but after about four or five times of playing it, it kind of loses its appeal because you're just kind of doing the same thing over and over again. Which is really frustrating because it potentially could be really cool. I've heard that there's supposed to be an expansion coming out. This is one of those weird rumors. I have no idea where it came from. This was Jerry talking last night. So I don't know where he gets his information from. There's supposed to be an expansion for Warhammer Quest Silver Tower that makes it a lot similar to the old Warhammer Quest. Because I never played the original Warhammer Quest. I played Hero Quest, and Warhammer Quest, I guess, is a little bit, quite a bit different. It might have been probably more complex. But it's still compatible with Silver Tower, but makes it play a little bit similar to the more older Warhammer Quest. And that's supposedly coming out. I have no idea if that's the case. Games Workshop doesn't have a great track record of supporting its board games very well. That may be intentional in their business model, because I kind of get the sense their board games are basically like, hey, here's a little board game. Now you've got some really cool miniatures. Here's this thing called Warhammer 40K or Warhammer Age of Sigmar you can play them with. Blood Bowl is the one exception so far. They've, like I said, they've released the Dwarven teams, but and they have one rule book, one expansion rule book, Season 1, that added some new teams in out. So they, with Blood Bowl, we may be actually seeing some legitimate expansions, but Space Hulk got very little. I think when they re-released Space Hulk a few years ago, when they released third edition, they might have added a few things to it, but there never really were any expansions for third edition of Space Hulk. Earlier maybe, but you know, that's older school GW. So I don't know what really to expect in terms of Silver Tower. It would be kind of neat to see more stuff, see them do something different, and you know, maybe have some more variety to the quest. And if you have more variety to the quest, you can play it more often and be a lot more fun to dive in and give it a shot. And the other thing I think issue ran into is there isn't really a scaling factor. Whereas, you know, some games, as you go longer into the scenario, the more the campaign goes on, monsters become tougher. There's something to make a given mission tougher. Silver Tower doesn't really have that, because you don't play the missions necessarily in order. You kind of choose how you want to play them. There's always a first one you start with, but after that you kind of choose. And there isn't really a scaling factor. There's a little bit with the whole respite and ambush and things. Unless we're playing things wrong, I don't know. But they didn't really feel like there was a whole lot of a scaling factor, to where as your characters get more powerful, somehow the mission gets harder, and it just makes the mission easier, and you just kind of rip through the monsters even faster. And it's, well, I don't know. There's one point where you have to battle like 50 goblins in different waves, and we just said, okay, we've gone through half the number of goblins. They aren't doing any damage to us. Mission successful. We're not going to spend another hour killing 25 more goblins, because we were so beefed up. They would just show up and we would kill them. in like two rounds. They couldn't hurt us at all, or we just heal ourselves back up. So it was a little frustrating. But it's a fun board game, and if you've got it, give it a try. And if you want some promotional items for Warhammer Quest Silver Tower, you can find them on an eBay store. I somehow acquired, long story short, I acquired a whole bunch of promotional stuff from Games Workshop that I'm trying to sell off for a few bucks. That's ebay.com, username Caladagia Games. I have like entire sets of Warhammer Quest, Silver Tower, promotional items. Some stuff for one of the Horus Heresy box sets. I don't remember which one it was. I think it's Bachilla Kalth. Because it has the Word Bearers as, like, for Ultramar on a little wristband thing. They're funny little gizmos like that. Let's see here. It's 4:45. Yeah, I'm going to paint the next wing. I think I can just... Let's get the other wing highlighted a little bit. And that'll be good for a first painting session here. It'd be kind of fun to bring other people in along, you know, this is not just me talking, have a little kind of talk show type format, so sitting here painting miniatures, that'd be kind of fun to try. Maybe not necessarily have to talk about gaming stuff, you could, who knows, ooh, dive into the dangerous world of politics and President Trump and... I can put together an interesting crew. We've got people who I know, friends who have volunteered for game companies. I obviously run my own. I know people. I probably couldn't get any of the local game store owners to show up. Maybe I might be able. Maybe that would be. It might be a bit of a stretch. But you know, I know people who run the vendor tables at conventions. Get them to join in. So we got to get nice. It'd be nice to see a show that talks a lot about the business side of the tabletop game industry. Because most of these podcasts and news sites, they're very much from the fan perspective. They rarely take a look at the financial side of things, which for a business is what really, really matters. You know, I mentioned a while ago, you know, if you're not buying stuff from the company... And, you know, you personally, or you as in an entire group, like the Warhammer Fantasy Battles group, you really can't be expecting loyalty from the company. And that's not to sound like they're being a jerk, but the companies are there to make money, to pay their employees, employ people, to pay, you know, to bring in revenue and dividends and all that stuff for their investors. That's what they have to do. And I feel... I noticed a lot of times with some of these news sites, their opinion pieces obviously don't really factor that kind of thing in at all. I remember the one. Oh, that one was hilarious. I don't know. Oh, I forget what news site is on, but their position was Age of Sigmar is stupid because Star Wars is going to rule the next 15 years of tabletop gaming. Well, let's just think about that for a while. That was their position of their article. They cited no sources, no information, nothing. They just simply stated, and you know, those are the kind of, sometimes you get low quality articles no matter where you go. Whew. On the topic of politics, wow. If you ever try to actually justify, try to read some of these opinion articles, whether it's pro-Trump, anti-Trump, oh my goodness. They're awful. People can't actually debate very well anymore. But that's a whole other topic altogether. They just shout talking points at each other. And those are really... That's really not debating. But yeah, go back to the whole... You know, Age of Sigmar is terrible because Star Wars is going to run the next 15 years of tabletop gaming. I don't... Obviously, I could sell a complete competing product to Star Wars stuff. But I think that position is a load of crap. Mainly because they didn't cite any evidence. Nothing whatsoever. They just... That's what they said and that was their opinion. Especially considering that history is against them. Because if you really think about it, list off in your head, you know, the most successful tabletop game franchises of all time. What do you've got, right? You've got Warhammer, both 40K and fantasy in all their forms. You got BattleTech. It's had like five different companies, but you know, it can't die. And there's still a pretty loyal fan base even today with classic BattleTech. You know, MechWarrior Dark Age had a run. You know, these kids. Of course, Magic the Gathering. You can't ignore Magic the Gathering. That's a monster in the industry. You've got, I mean, I guess you would call Catan. Settlers of Catan, one of the main players in the tabletop game industry. I don't really put Euro games in the same category of awesome miniature games, but, you know, it makes a lot of money. War Machine, that's going on, 14 years now? 14, 15 years, something like that? I forget, is it 2002, 2003? One of those two got released. So it's not going anywhere for a while. But the point is, the major brands that are consistent are all original table... Oh, Dungeons & Dragons. Can't forget Dungeons & Dragons. But the major brands that are consistent are all original tabletop game properties. There's reasons for that. There's no licensing to fight with. So if something like with Star Wars, eventually you're going to run out of stuff to put in the game. Or in some cases where they've had, you know, franchises like that, the game owners do something, you know, I mean, and just tick off the license holders and they revoke the license. So while it's certainly possible that, you know, Star Wars could have a nice long run as a tabletop game franchise, and it really has. I mean, Star Wars never really went anywhere, but as a single franchise, from a game perspective, it never really lasted a whole long time. It kind of came and went in different forms, different companies produced different games. But the gaming history is really a lot more unstable, per se, than things like BattleTech or Warhammer, even though they've changed, obviously Warhammer's changed a lot over the years. But it's still maintained by the same companies, and it's still, you can still use a lot of the miniatures. But it's just been more successful as a franchise, because it really has been less, yeah, I see change, but then of course Age of Sigmar, but you know. They just tend to be more stable long term than the licensed properties. But you never know. We'll see how things go. X-Wing sells a lot. Armada, I don't think Armada does quite as well. They don't release as much stuff for it, but it quite possibly, you know, we don't really know anything about sales, but obviously if they're still making stuff, it's got to be making them money. You don't cancel a successful product, usually. Unless you're weird. I'm looking at you, HP. I'm not bitter 7 years later about WebOS. Never. When was that? I guess that was only five. Was that 6 years ago? That's about a little less than 6 years ago. The whole let's cancel WebOS and get out of the devices. That's going off into random tangents. I'm not bitter about that still. WebOS is still better than Android and iOS at the time, and if it was still around, it'd probably still be a lot better. WebOS fanboy forever. That's the sad reality of it. I should get a shirt that says, that'd be hilarious. WebOS forever. And it's like the cart. You have to do like the little card icons and do something goofy like that. Oh, that would be funny. So anyway, back to the whole fan business perspective, and it's something, and it's really something that I've learned by running, you know, Legends of Caladasia, where it's a business. I gotta make money, and frankly, you know, I make a sizable chunk of money selling Warhammer crap on eBay, because I have to make money. I don't want to do that, but I do. That's how you supplement your income, right? I resell people's armies on eBay. I buy and sell used Warhammer stuff is basically the short story. And I make a decent chunk of money doing that. that? I don't know. Something just weird fell. I don't know. I'll dig it up later. I'm almost done here. But I'll definitely be running plenty of more live streams of this for quite a while to come. I mean, I've got a lot of this miniature to paint. It'll be a long time, but you know what? It'll be fun. I honestly haven't sat down to paint miniatures a whole lot, not as much as I used to. When the tabletop battlefield started, I had the unofficial policy that the miniatures all had to be painted before we could do a review of the game. I think right around third season, that kind of was gone. So I'm pretty sure Blood Bowl, back to where I started today, I'm pretty sure their Blood Bowl review, the miniatures were not painted. My Lizardmen were painted, that I played with, because, you know, I wanted those guys to look awesome. But the Orcs and the Humans were definitely not painted, and I don't think they're even painted to this day. I actually don't even know where that is. It's probably in my parents' basement. I've got like the giant box of games I don't play anymore. My best guess is it's probably in there. But if they do, if Games Workshop does end up releasing a new Lizardmen team, which I'm really hoping they will, it'd be kind of fun to get that. The old Blood Bowl Lizardmen miniatures were based like on 4th or 5th edition Warhammer Fantasy. They were the design previous to what the current Saurus and Skinks look like. I'm not sure when exactly that was. That was before that I started playing the game, because when I got into Warhammer Fantasy, it was already the current design of the Skinks and the Saurus Warriors, the more modern, cooler-looking design. Well, the Skinks didn't change a whole lot. The Skinks look kind of like what they did, but the Saurus Warriors changed a lot at some point, about 10, 11, 12 years ago, which I started Warhammer about 10 years ago. Actually, it might be more than that. No, it was 2006 I got into 40K. Yeah, 2006 I got into 40K. And then shortly afterwards, I got into Warhammer Fantasy. So, before 11 years ago or so, Games Workshop made a pretty substantial physical appearance change to the Lizardmen Saurus Warriors. And the Blood Bowl miniatures are that generation from before they made that big change. And they look like crap. Man, I didn't like them even. And it's really just amazing to see how, just across the entire industry, even shameless self-promotion, Legends of Caladagia, there's a miniature, how much miniature design has just improved over the years. It's just fantastic how much better they are. Like, this guy I got in my hands right now is only possible because of amazing advancements in plastics, primarily thanks to Games Workshop. You could never do this thing in cuter. I mean, resin, you kind of could, but these fiddly bits just don't work in resin. Oh, I can't see, I'm flicking the wings around. These fiddly bits just don't work very well in resin. They're so thin, they snap. I mean, you could probably do this guy in resin if you really wanted to, but, man, he would be expensive. Trying to hand cast, you have to cast all these parts individually, all the molds. It's a very manually, very time-consuming type thing. All right, well, I think that's looking pretty good for a first rambling, talking session of painting Kairos Fate Weaver. I should come up with some sort of schedule for this. Thursdays at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Let me switch back to my main camera here to finish up after I wash off my artificial brush. There we go. There we go. So anyway, so like Thursdays at 8 p.m. Eastern Time is when I paint up the Legends of Caladagia miniatures. I'm currently working on the brand new Surkar Corona. This guy here, it just came out last week.
So at Kalidasia.com, KALIDASIA.com, you can actually find him for sale. It's a $12 kit, includes the miniature and the flight stand, all that fun stuff. And of course, that goes along with Legends of Kaladasia Heroes of the Irghul, which is the second edition of Legends of Kaladasia, which introduces all sorts of really cool new features to the game. And it's definitely a lot cooler game than first edition. And I'm not just saying that to try to sell it. I do enjoy it a lot more. But now we're going to call that good for Kairos Fate Weaver today. Like I said, it's going to be a long time this guy is done. So I don't know if I'm going to have a set schedule for him. It might just be jump on whenever I feel like. But I'll post these live stream videos over on my old Tabletop Battlefield Rocker Robotics YouTube channel if you want to catch up on them. And I don't know, it'd be fun to try to get some other people in. Mind painting this guy, have them come in and you could talk back and forth and have a little bit of a fun little talk show just sitting here painting miniatures. That'd be kind of cool to do. That's really something that'd be fun to try. Maybe we'll do that sometime. But I will be back on sometime later this week, probably, to get some more work done on this guy. It's going to be a long time till he's done. I got more highlights to put on the wings. We're going to continue on here with Moot Green. That's a really bright one. And then probably some Beal Tan Green on the topic of Gathering Storm 2. And then I'll probably start working on trying to figure out what would be a cool paint scheme here for the wings. I'm thinking I'll go some brown orange like I like to do because I got lots of those paints sitting around. You know how that works. Anyway, alright, well thank you for watching this live stream here. Once again, I'm Jason, the creator of all sorts of fun things, Tabletop Battlefield, Legends of Kaladasia, and all that stuff. You can find that in links in the YouTube show notes. So once again, thank you for watching and have a good night.